I am William Castle, the director of the motion picture you're about to see. I feel obligated to warn you that some of the sensations, some of the physical reactions, which the actors on the screen will feel, will also be experienced for the first time in motion picture history by certain members of this audience. I say certain members because some people are more sensitive to these mysterious electronic impulses than others. These unfortunate, sensitive people will at times feel a strange, tingling sensation. Others will feel it less strongly. But don't be alarmed, you can protect yourself. At any time you are conscious of a tingling sensation, you may obtain immediate relief by screaming. Don't be embarrassed about opening your mouth and letting rip with all you've got, because the person in the seat right next to you will probably be screaming too. And remember this, a scream at the right time may save your life.
Good evening, one and all. It's Take Two, the movie program on public radio, KCBX, broadcasting from San Luis Obispo, California. Opening up our program tonight, one of the great film hucksters of all time, William Castle, one of our subjects on tonight's show. And across the aisle from me, a man whose probably only regret was the fact that he didn't star in a film directed by William Castle or Russ Meyer. It's the one, the only, Bob Whiteford.
That's true. I'll never get to live my life's ambition. And across the aisle from me, the one and only czar, undisputed czar of film on the Central Coast, your friend and mine. Of course, I'm talking about Jim Dee. Gosh, it was great to hear William Castle hustling his wares. You know, I was just thinking, Jim, what would William Castle do with the internet?
Nothing, obviously.
Nothing, because we couldn't smell his cigar smoke.
Well, tonight we have a very interesting double feature show for you. In fact, before we begin, we'd like to say hello to our friend Ricardo in Mexico City, who listened to our program, podcasting. And we'd also like to mention you can hear Take Two, the movie program, at the KCBX website, streaming, kcbx.org. Anyway, back to the show. We read all about the infamous Snakes on a Plane, which was apparently destined for blockbuster status, but fell way below the expectations of the distributor. I think we kind of agree that this was an internet phenomenon, and I think everyone stayed on the internet, didn't go to the movie theater. The $15 million opening, which is probably not too bad. If we're talking about William Castle and Russ Meyer, $15 million would be a huge amount, but we have to, you know, make those changes for 2006. However, Bob and I were talking about the idea of so-called cult films or films that are marketed in a certain way with very gimmicky promotions. And we read that Snakes on a Plane didn't quite cut it in this sort of contrived genre way. They're already considering Snakes on a Plane a dud. However, we started thinking about the pioneers of exploitation and sexploitation. A couple of guys who may not even be doing things, who wouldn't be doing what they'd been doing, what they were doing back in the 60s now. But we're talking about two great hucksters of film, William Castle and Russ Meyer. We're going to look at both of their careers tonight on Take Two.
Well, you know, starting off with William Castle, and I'd also like to say, hola, Ricardo. Viva Ricardo. William Castle. Now, here's a guy who was just born to be an exploitation filmmaker. He started out doing a little drama and whatnot in New York, got a job through, I think, his brother-in-law or something, or his brother at Columbia Pictures. I think his brother was a film editor, and he came over. Came out to the West Coast because I read his book. His autobiography is a great read.
Wow.
It's I would say it's John Waters' Bible. So to get back to the story, he ultimately hooks up with, oh gosh, I can't remember who the filmmaker was. I know Harry Cohn was the president of Columbia Pictures at the time. And William Castle got a shot to direct. He worked with Orson Welles on Lady from Shanghai. And Welles, not very popular with Harry Cohn, as one might imagine, the iron-fisted, cigar-chomping mogul of Columbia Pictures. But as a young man, he did take on a few B-movie, horror movie, film noirs, and made his statement. The guy was actually a terrific filmmaker in his own right for what he did. And we're talking, folks, these are the guys that make good films with no money and very little time.
Plus putting a little extra oomph into the promotion, which would also include some sort of gimmick or something that would get you into the theater. Our opening was William Castle at the beginning of The Tingler from 1959. And those sensitive people he was talking about are the ones who had their theater seats wired, who would get a little zap now and again. And of course, here's William Castle already egging you on to start screaming when that happens. And so he's already got this reaction built into his movie. What a guy.
He's amazing. I mean, here's a cat who outside the theater, he has somebody selling heart attack insurance.
A nurse on duty all the time because
exactly.
In case you have a, yeah, in case you die.
during House on Haunted Hill, he had theaters wired up that had skeletons coming across, you know, above your heads, you know, rubber skeletons or something ridiculous like that. But he had fun. He was a showman, kind of like a low-budget P.T. Barnum of films. And like Alfred Hitchcock, he just couldn't resist being in some of his pictures himself.
Most of them, apparently, you know, especially the later ones. In fact, Bob, you know, when we did the research here on William Castle, I fondly remember him in the 60s and seeing these movies in the movie theaters. But the titles like The Tingler or House on Haunted Hill or Homicidal or 13 Ghosts, of course, come to mind. But going all the way back to 1943, he was directing. And looking at his filmography, I mean, he's got something like, you know, 40 films before he started getting into his, you know, his really great stuff, the 13 Ghosts, the stuff that he would do these wonderfully gimmicky promotions. But, you know, I do want to look into some of these other films, you know, aside from the show, because I had no idea that William Castle directed 60 films in all. And it was in the latter part of his career in the 1960s is when, you know, he started really coming out with his ultimate huckster selling of the films with these great gimmicky promotions.
Well, I think it starts with Macabre in 1958. That's where he starts to, I think he's independent at mm-hmm. this point. He's back with his old studio. Well, he did a lot of films in his later years with his old studio, Columbia. He also did some with Allied Artists, which a few years before was known as Monogram, one of the great Poverty Row outfits, but giving him total freedom to do whatever the heck he wanted to do. You know, I think, let's see, you know, the Tingler, it's a classic. That's his second teaming with Vincent Price. His first was House on Haunted Hill. And I got to tell you, Jimmy, when I saw this movie when I was a little kid, that, it really freaked me out. And you know what I'm thinking about? The old lady in the wine cellar who's going around like this, the blind old lady with the hair coming out
yes.
like crazy.
Yes.
What a great film that is. That still stands up pretty well. I mean, who could forget Elisha Cook Jr. or Richard Long? Just a wonderful, over-the-top, scary, and kind of funny movie.
Yes.
Very entertaining.
I think before we went on there, we were discussing the, shall we say, distant cousins of some of these exploitation directors. And in the current, in the year 2000 on, it seems like the slasher movie makes it to the number one spot. We're talking about the remake of The Hills Have Eyes, or Saw seems to be a franchise now. I think the third one's going to be coming out, one called Hostel. And I think on these exploitation films, I think what they're trying to feed upon is how graphic can you get with the violence? How, you know, in other words, it's almost daring the teenagers to come in and say, you know, hey, sit through this. We're gonna shock you, which is kind of, you know, the same thing that these guys were doing. But I think it's lacking that sense of humor. We'll get into more of William Castle's inherent humor and fun that he's having with these pictures, even though he's still trying to scare you. And as we get into Russ Meyer in the second half of the show, even though we're on the tip of, shall we say, pornography or some very scintillating cinema, he too had a sense of humor and a sense of vision that was, you know, he wanted both of these people wanted you to have a great time in the movie theater. I think that's the bottom line.
Absolutely, Jimmy. In fact, that's well put. You know, the film we got a clip of here, this is kind of William Castle paying an homage to Alfred Hitchcock, who in turn had paid an homage to him.
Yes, with Psycho.
With Psycho, showing that he could make a low-budget film that was kind of scary. And not to be outdone, you know, William Castle was just chomping on his, you know, his cigar, saying, "I've got it now. He's followed me. Now I've got to rip him off again." And he comes out with the kind of cult classic Homicidal, a film that's not seen very often, and this has got an even more depraved transvestite killer. And it also takes place in Solvang, California.
That's a special note because the KCBX listening area includes Solvang. And folks, if you didn't know this, but the 1961 William Castle film Homicidal filmed in Solvang. If you want to see what it looked like in the early 60s, check out this movie. If you don't know anything about Solvang, check it out anyway.
You know, I just remembered the name of the lead in this film, Jim. Her name was Jean Arliss. Now, she's a woman playing a man who's disguised as a woman. I don't know. It's very confusing. I can't. It's been a while. Even if I saw the picture a week ago, I'd still be scratching my head as to the actual gender of the star in question. However, this is a very entertaining, low-budget film that, let's face it, the transsexual killer, I mean, you know, this is a little ahead of its time. These days it's commonplace to find in movies. 1960, 61 with Psycho and Homicidal, this is pretty risque territory. And William Castle jumps in with both loafers.
Here's a scene from Homicidal, and again, this takes place in Solvang, California. And as is true to Psycho, for instance, the explanation of why Norman Bates was the way he was. Here we have the good doctor heading into the pharmacy, and the pseudoscience will also explain why someone becomes homicidal.
Closing early, Carl?
Yeah, I'm driving to Ventura, Doc.
Oh, hate to bother you, but I need some sleeping pills for a patient.
Can take you a minute.
Sure, a couple of minutes won't make any difference.
If you need anything else, Doc, the store might be closed tomorrow.
Oh? Any trouble, Carl?
Well, I don't know.
It was a brutal murder, wasn't it? It always shocks me to read something like that. But nowadays, people seem to hate more.
Is there any way to tell?
Huh? Tell what, Carl?
Well, if a person's homicidal.
Yeah. No, that's what makes them so dangerous. They can change from being your friend into your murderer in a second's time. Anyone in mind, Carl?
Just asking.
We all hate to a certain extent. You'd be surprised at the murderous daydreams that some sweet old ladies indulge in. But it's only when hate is dammed up that it breaks out in murder. Try to imagine an infant enraged over some slight frustration, like having his toy taken away. Then think of him with the strength and imagination of an adult. He would kill. Well, in some ways, the person with homicidal tendencies has never developed emotionally beyond that point.
Well, there you have it, Bob.
I don't know. It makes sense to me.
That's from the William Castle film Homicidal from 1961, and again, filmed in Solvang, California. And, you know, you could listen to that dialogue and think of a Hitchcock film, or just think that, hey, well, this dialogue would be part of a Hitchcock film. And William Castle, a big fan of Hitchcock. I think he was a ultimate Hitchcock wannabe. But I also think he made the films that he wanted to make and did what he wanted to do.
And I think maybe in a small way, Hitchcock was a little bit of a fan of his, too.
Oh, I'll bet.
If nothing else, you got to just love the man's audacity.
Yes. Well, speaking of audacity, I'll relate a personal story that I have of our next William Castle film called Zots, which is William Castle doing kind of an absent-minded professor, you know, Shaggy Dog, the cheap Disney production where it's good for all ages. The plot of this film, Tom Poston is an archaeologist or a school teacher who comes across a coin, an ancient coin, where if you have it in your possession, if you point at somebody, they have horrible pain. If you say Zots, I think everything slows down. And if you point and say Zots at the same time, it's instant death. And this is taken to comedic lengths when Tom Poston is enlisted by the U.S. government. He's considered a secret weapon. But there's also all sorts of comedy in this film by William Castle. The story I need to tell is when I went to see this when I was 10 or 11, they had Zots coins at the theater. That was my main drive to go. I have to remember I had to get that coin, and I was all excited, and the movie was fun, and when I left I had this piece of plastic that said Zots on it, and I was, you know, a happy kid. And I was thinking William Castle totally won me over. Here was a perfect example of being sucked into a gimmicky promotion, and I loved it. I had fun watching bits of Zots today.
It's brilliant. I mean, for a 2 cent coin, you get somebody to spend $1, $1.50 to get you in the movie.
Yes.
Genius.
You know, it's interesting, too, you mentioned that, Bob, because I think what's important to get our listeners' frame of mind into is the fact in the 1960s, when these films were happening, you know, for instance, when we talk about Russ Meyer, his films were not shown on television, for instance.
No.
If they did show some of the William Castle films on TV, heck, you didn't get the tinted red blood in a few scenes of The Tingler. You didn't get the Zots coin, you know. Or you didn't get your seat wired when you were watching The Tingler as well. Or
you didn't get your heart attack insurance or any of that.
And it was the getting into that frame of mind that a movie was an experience as opposed to the days today where we have DVDs, we have videos where you can own it, you can discard it. It was more of a definite experience, and it was more cerebral, and, you know, even more cerebral if you're going, you know, with the nurse out in the lobby to make sure you're not going to drop dead.
Dare I say, Jim, kind of an interactive experience.
Yes.
I remember a film William Castle did around the same time as Homicidal. It was called Mr. Sardonicus. Do you remember that? It had Guy Rolfe in it.
Yes, I remember the smile when you saw him. He had that really creepy skull-like face.
And in the middle of the film, or toward the end, toward the last reel.
That's right.
Yeah, Castle comes out on this bridge in London after midnight, and he says, okay, now you get to decide Mr. Sardonicus's fate.
Ah.
Do you vote thumbs up, thumbs down. And the way it's filmed, it appears he's talking to the audience. It's a foregone conclusion. It's a kangaroo court. Mr. Sardonicus and his evil ways, it's thumbs down. He will be punished severely. But having William Castle dressed up in late 19th century attire in a set probably rejected from some Jack the Ripper remake, sucking on that cigar, it's kind of a kick. It's just something you don't see every day.
Well, like you said, Bob, so perfectly, that it grabs you by the nape of the neck and gets you involved, whether it's holding the coin or getting zapped or deciding the fate of Mr. Sardonicus. It's, you're not only interacting with the movie as you normally do, but there's a little more you can do with these gimmicky productions.
And William Castle, more than happy to be front and center as the focal point.
Let's hear a clip from The House on Haunted Hill. Here again at the opening of the picture, I think what William Castle does is kind of dares the audience and gets you wrapped in right at the beginning. Here is Vincent Price from The House on Haunted Hill.
I'm Frederick Lauren, and I've rented the house on Haunted Hill tonight so that my wife can give a party, a haunted house party. She's so amusing. There'll be food and drink and ghosts, and perhaps even a few murders. You're all invited. If any of you will spend the next 12 hours in this house, I'll give you each $10,000, or your next of kin in case you don't survive. Ah, but here come our other guests.
You know what's a kick about this, Jim? This is Vincent Price being William Castle.
Yes.
He's stepped into the William Castle role. And this film is so much fun because it's all gimmick-based. $10,000 from a mysterious millionaire to spend a night in a haunted house. And you've got murder, you've got mayhem, you've got shocks, you've got laughter, you got camp, you've got all kinds of stuff going on in this pad. And it's a good-natured romp. I wish the remake had some of that. It didn't, though.
Yeah. The genius of the line of Vincent Price, you know, essentially betting the audience. I'll bet you $10,000, you know, you're not going to survive this house or this film or whatever. Or we're going to give you a good jolt. And I just love that sort of setup right at the beginning that, you know, it's almost like betting the audience that, okay, we're going to let you have it here.
Yeah, you're getting set up. And the thing is, does the film deliver? Well, it almost doesn't matter.
No.
In a sense, it really doesn't. You're in for the full ride. It's 77 minutes of pure B movie, low budget, black and white bliss.
You know, and I think we should also say, Bob, that these films made on a shoestring budget and creatively promoted, that's the best word I've used tonight, creatively. You know, instead of hucksters and you know, these guys selling us a load of goods, so to speak. But they made a lot of money. I mean, they were successful. And when I'm looking at William Castle's filmography here, he was churning out films for the most part, like 2 and 3 a year. And right up to when he stopped making films, it looks like in about late 60s or so. But still, he was very prolific. But you're turning them out at a low cost, and you're filling the theaters with these gimmicks. I mean, these guys were making the money. But I also think, as we mentioned before we went on the air, both William Castle and Russ Meyer were doing this because they were probably were making films they enjoyed. Mm-hmm. I think their eye was on the money, but their eye was also on making a really fun film that they would have fun watching in the movie theater.
Absolutely. And not unlike maybe the greatest exploitation guru of them all, Roger Corman, probably not one frame of film wasted. Not a lot of outtakes from their movies.
Or not one set wasted. You could use it on three or four movies if you
actually,
could.
Actually, that's true. I mean, we know this is true with Roger Corman. Mm-hmm. It's also true with William Castle. I mean, you check out The Tingler, House on Haunted Hill, and 13 Ghosts. It's obvious that they've all been shot on the same back lot. They look very similar. I mean, they were shot probably one right after the other, you know, with slightly different casts and whatnot. But it certainly has the look that they, you know, he must have shot it all in the same, just moved things around a little bit. I'm half expecting Leave It to Beaver to show up in The Tingler. He must be right around the corner or something.
They're filming the next house down at the Cleaver residence, you know. Here's our last film that we're going to talk about with the great William Castle is a film I remember seeing when it first came out in the theaters. It was remade. I don't even want to see the remake. I guess it was filled with all sorts of computer-generated effects and so on, even though it had Lily Taylor in it, I guess. The original 13 Ghosts had viewers, you know, like 3D glasses, although the film was not in 3D. It, of course, had this little notation down below the screen, I think, use viewer, and then you could see the ghosts. If you didn't put the glasses on, you didn't see the ghosts. When you put the glasses on, you saw them. It was a kick. What was also get you into the film as well is members of the cast had a pair of the glasses, too, except they were much more cool in the movie.
Yeah.
You know, mine were like cardboard or whatever they were, but the ones in the movie were very cool, and the characters in the film would don these glasses and they would see the ghosts in the film 13 Ghosts. And I got the biggest kick out of the film. I specifically remember where I saw it. Just the gimmick of the glasses was really fun. And of course, when we play this clip, we'll go even further into the kind of fun, self-referential, and humor of William Castle when you hear the dialogue with some of the cast. Shall we play it?
Let's do it, Jimmy.
Let's see if you recognize the voices here. This is at the end of 13 Ghosts. The person being addressed and being asked about the ghosts in the house is the voice we want you to try to recognize. This is from William Castle's 13 Ghosts.
Breakfast is ready.
Well, I'm starved.
Elaine, do you think there's still ghosts in this house?
No. The earthbound spirits have been released. Don't you want your breakfast?
I'm guarding the money.
Elaine?
Yes, Buck?
You really are a witch, aren't you?
Ask me no questions, and I'll tell you no lies.
And the ghosts? They haven't really gone, have they?
They'll be back. They'll be back.
Real soon, I hope.
Now, did you recognize the voice? That's from 13 Ghosts. And Elaine is, I guess, her name. She was also the medium to contact the ghosts in this film. The one, the only Margaret Hamilton, who played the Wicked Witch in The Wizard of Oz. The wonderful twist in this film, the fun tongue-in-cheek, is the fact that here's the little boy star calling her, well, you're a witch, aren't you? You know, and you know William Castle is just having the most fun with this by having her in the cast and having her playing a similar role as she played in The Wizard of Oz.
And let's not forget Martin Milner.
Yes.
In a very pivotal role in his career. This is probably what got him Adam 12.
But he's not such a good guy in this one.
No, this is probably the only film, this and Valley of the Dolls, I think were the only ones where he plays, Valley of the Dolls, he wasn't a bad guy. He was just driven mishugana by Patty Duke, as were we all. But yeah, I think this is the only film I ever remember him being a heavy.
Well, Bob and I highly recommend not only the films, but the promotional practices of William Castle, an icon of the 1960s who, You know, maybe would have lent a little more box office to Snakes on a Plane. If he was around, he might have had a good idea to promote it in a different way. Maybe have actual snakes in the theater. How about that? That would have worked.
Well, he would have been very upset because no one would let him smoke his cigars.
Well, we're talking about exploitation and our second half of tonight's double feature show on Take Two, the movie program. We're going to be discussing another master of promotion as well as creating a film genre all unto himself. We're talking about Russ Meyer, the infamous Russ Meyer. This is Public Radio, KCBX San Luis Obispo, KSBX Santa Barbara, streaming at kcbx.org. It's Take Two, the movie program. Over to the concession stand, back with Russ Meyer in just a moment.
Come on, y'all, butter that popcorn.
Funds for Take Two, the movie program, have been provided in part by Morin Brothers Automotive, which is newly expanded to better serve their customers. Frida the Diagnostic Dog invites you to check out her new digs at Morin Brothers, servicing Volvo, Saab, and most domestic and Japanese cars. We're back on Take Two, the movie program on Public Radio, KCBX. My name is Jim Dee. I'm here with Bob Whiteford. We're talking about the, well, seeming failure of Snakes on a Plane, which, the expectations for it were huge. It didn't seem to pan out. And Bob and I got into the frame of mind of the great hucksters, the great promoters of low-budget films, and yet they had a knack for either promoting sensationally and making a lot of money on low-budget films, or in some cases, creating some true works of art, even though we'll put them in their own separate category.
Even in spite of their exploitative tendencies.
Yes. So our first half hour devoted to William Castle is the ultimate exploitation director, at least back in the 60s with the great gimmicks. And now we are going to look at the career of Russ Meyer. We could have devoted an entire show to this guy, but an icon. And as we did some research on Russ, not only our own viewing of his unique and tantalizing movies, but acclaim that Russ Meyer has gotten over the years, you know, truly is the fact that this guy was a pioneer. He was unique. He was doing things that, out of the ultimate reverence for being an American. I think Russ Meyer, in a lot of his films, really put forth the idea of free speech, free expression. Of course, in his hands, that means anything goes.
Pretty much.
Anything goes. But I think he held to that. I think it's at the beginning of Cherry, Harry, and Raquel, where he has, talking about rights being taken away for free speech, and we shouldn't let this happen, and in a free society, we should be able to view whatever we want, and so on and so forth. Now, having said that, we're going to get into the career of Russ Meyer. And Bob, you came up with this great clip from a documentary called Shooting War, and getting into the history of Russ Meyer and the fact that he was a World War II correspondent, essentially, and was there in the thick of it and had his camera rolling.
That's the thing. He was a combat film cameraman. And he landed at Omaha Beach on D-Day, some of that grainy black and white footage you see of the invasion was shot by Russ Meyer. Most of the stuff he shot ended up in the English Channel because, as we know, the landing was utter chaos and a bloodbath, which in turn would be how it would be across the campaign across France into Germany. Very bloody, very a very powerful experience for a young man. Obviously, and think about this, Jim. When I think of Russ Meyer, especially at this stage in his life, I'm reminded of the film Medium Cool, the Haskell Wexler film.
Yes.
And that film, Haskell Wexler, one of the great cinematographer, cameramen in the history of Hollywood, the idea of what's the cameraman seeing? How's it affecting him as he's looking through the lens? It's certainly got to be more than just technical expertise, light exposure. You know, do you have your camera in the right, you know, you're getting the right frames per second, all that technical stuff. But it's got to be affecting you as a human being, what you're looking at. And there's an interesting interview from this film, Shooting War, with Russ Meyer talking about his experiences as a cameraman for the Army. And maybe we could play that clip.
Yeah, here's a clip. The film is called Shooting War. The first person talking is another cinematographer who worked during World War II. Then you'll hear the voice of Tom Hanks and also the voice of Russ Meyer and what he was doing during World War II. This is from the film Shooting War.
Well, it's not commonly known that our pre-invasion bombardment killed a lot of French people who were living behind the line. I was always amazed at the fact that the French people I photographed didn't blame the Americans for what was taking place. They regarded us as liberators, even though it was our bombs that killed some of the people who lived there.
There was a sweetness in these welcomes and a certain haste. After the Normandy breakout, it finally became a war of movement. And for this Free French Tank Battalion, it was a very personal war, as Russ Meyer learned when he joined them.
Right off the bat, took our Jeep right with the tank, like the French tank. We'd go right between them.
His best wartime buddy, Bill Tees, was already with the French unit. He would lend his name to the title of Meyer's first post-war erotic hit, The Immoral Mr. Tees. Needless to say, the French tankers were welcomed with special warmth as they rolled through their native land. The Americans were included in that welcome.
And they would all say, oh, American, très bien.
There was danger on these roads, too.
You go down the street, and the guy says, stop it. He says, just stop right now. Don't go. There's a bunch of Germans right down that road. Now get the hell out of there.
Forewarned, they engaged in a brief, violent firefight. This time, they took prisoners.
I'd love to know the guy today. Because if we hadn't been warned, we'd have had someone had gotten our tonsils.
But they weren't always so lucky.
That's a clip from a film called Shooting War. It's all about cinematographers who were in the thick of it. Russ Meyer was one of them, and boy, he came very close to a lot of danger. Although earlier in this film, there's a short clip of Russ Meyer who said he loved it because he loved the danger. It was just like he was in the thick of World War II. He just loved it. He was probably, hair standing up on all ends, but boy, the camera was rolling.
Yeah, he seemed to be one of those unique type of individuals that got very excited. War was something that kind of grounded him in its chaos and possibility of imminent death, which is kind of interesting. A little sidebar to this is there's the legendary story now, and if it's legendary, I don't know if it's true or not. I'd like to believe it was true, but Ernest Hemingway was a war correspondent as well, and there's a story that Hemingway, who known for his love of drink and good times, took Russ Meyer to a French house of ill repute during the liberation in the summer of 1944, which, along with the carnage of the campaign, seemed to have planted the seed for what was to become RM International, Russ Meyer, the king of sexploitation cinema. What's interesting, Jim, is after the war, he was a photographer, and a fashion photographer that very quickly turned into shooting for Playboy, the seminal Playboy magazine. In fact, I think his first wife, Eve Meyer, was a centerfold for Playboy. He had quite a reputation. He photographed a lot of the most beautiful women of his day, or maybe of any day. And what's interesting, I have to mention Eve Meyer here because they made a really good team. Russ Meyer was the creative force, but Eve Meyer was the behind-the-scenes force. She was very good at making deals. She was very good at being a producer. She did a lot of the behind-the-scenes work, which made them a very solid team, because when they made the immoral Mr. T's in 1958, and I think they also followed up with Eve and the Handyman
in 1961.
You found that they were making films for maybe $20,000 that were incredibly well made. I mean, Russ Meyer's eye as a photographer, and I might add his real talent, which I think puts him amongst the greats in cinema, period, is as a film editor. Russ Meyer is one of the greatest editors of film that ever lived. And you couple that with the fact that he could actually get performances out of people that weren't professional actors because he was so good at editing, he could in post-production, he could clean things up. This guy was on his way, because The Immoral Mr. T's was a huge success. For $20,000, I think he made his first million. He was off and running.
Wow. And what's very interesting, well, just to give an overview of the filmography of Russ Meyer, he made a total of 27 films. His first film was called The French Peep Show. The Immoral Mr. T's was in 1959. But we do have to say the area that Russ Meyer worked in was not only pioneering almost a whole new genre, a whole new type of film, but of course it was always erotic. There was always a bevy of beautiful women everywhere. And then when you talk about the editing, Bob, I mean, there was almost this stream of consciousness thing going on where some of his films are going along, and of course, flash in a naked woman here and there, just like, whoa, what was that? I mean, it's not subliminal. It's
oh no,
a borderline subliminal. But when we get back to that idea that both William Castle and Russ Meyer had a sense of humor. In the case of Russ Meyer, of course, he liked to go on the provocative side. He would touch on almost any subject. Heck, when we get to Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, we're talking about anything goes.
Pretty much.
Some of the cast members in the DVD release are just talking about, well, this guy is really a woman. Or Roger Ebert's talking about, well, here's homosexuality, or here's drugs and this sort of thing. And they said Russ Meyer just didn't bat an eye. He just went along with it. He just, says, let's just throw in everything but the kitchen sink. And, we are moving ahead in his career, but talking about Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, the one film that was, released by a big studio, it's considered to be one of the greatest cult films of all time. And even when you look at it now, it's unlike any other film, I think, that exists on the planet, maybe for a good reason.
Absolutely. We're kind of jumping ahead here, but I think to really grasp the Russ Meyer legend, especially to people who aren't familiar with him, You've got to start with Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. It came out in 1970. He had just had a string of hits, again, an independent filmmaker with a capital I. All his films made a lot of money. I think his last film before he signed with 20th Century Fox was Vixen with the lovely Erica Gavin, truly one of my favorite Russ Meyer starlets. So, you know, based on that, 20th Century Fox. And remember, Jim, like in the late 60s, early around 1970, the studios were in trouble. Television, a lack of creativity. It sounds kind of familiar, doesn't it? But then what they decided, unlike now, is to take some chances, bring some people in, and not have him make his kind of movie with a 20th Century Fox type of budget and production values. And Beyond the Valley of the Dolls is one of the most mind-blowing, excessive things I have ever seen. This is entertainment on a scale hitherto unknown and maybe never rivaled since. John Waters kind of he works this territory really well. He's about the only one I know of that really can touch on this kind of stuff and make it happen. And what's amazing about this film, amongst many things, amongst maybe starting with the fact that it even got made, was the fact that he's doing this with novice actors and actresses.
Yes.
No, I mean, there's a couple of Playboy centerfolds, but there's nobody in there really with a lot of acting experience. There's a few character actors, Charles Napier, Sue Bernard. She had a sexploitation career of sorts. And the aforementioned Erica Gavin, who
Big smile on your face, Bob.
Yeah, big smile. But it's just pretty amazing what he's done with this. And it's written by Roger Ebert.
I know.
And this is a film that for years he would disown. And now he's very proud of it. Because I think now our sensibilities today appreciate the genius of this film far more than they did back in 1970.
Or just the brazen nature. It's just like, let's pull out all the stops. Let's just go for it. But then you have the keen eye of his camera. You have the colors. And you just, what's interesting is some of the commentary in the DVD, they're saying, you know, in Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, they're using all these terms like groovy and, you know, stoned and all this sort of thing, but it's just not quite right, you know.
Yeah, everything's just a little off, and that makes it even better.
Yes. Well, let's treat our listeners. We're going to play the trailer for Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. Then we're going to play you some commentary of reactions to the film, not only critics, but some of the cast. So why don't you sit down, brace yourself. Here's the trailer from Russ Meyer's Beyond the Valley of the Dolls.
Recently, 20th Century Fox had two very heavy ideas. First, make a film called Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. Second, get Russ Meyer to write, produce, and direct it. You'll meet three girls, young, beautiful, talented, a tight trio that was the heart and soul of a rock group. Life was sweet, man, but not enough. The whole world was out there just waiting, and the beat inside pushed them to where it's happening. Hollywood, USA. Yeah, it happened all right. They got hooked on a non-stop merry-go-round where the only ticket you need is success. Be a winner, man, or forget it. When they made that first party, it was like too late. The whole thing was moving, reaching out, and they dug it. Whites, yellows, and reds were more than just colors, man. They were it, the magic dream pills. The chicks were wild and groovy. The studs were cool and cruel. The eyes so warm, the smile so friendly. But watch the teeth. They bite deep. Faces, so many faces, calling, begging, help me, love me, save me. Don't listen. If you hear them, you've had it. Come on, open your mouth wider. Here, taste. Life, man, life. Like it? Hell no, tough. It's a one-way trip all the way down. One little girl turns her back on truth and love. She'll have to make it with pain and eyes that cry rivers. The second finds her heart in the arms of another chick. Don't look for evil in your brother's eye. The third bird finds her man. It's good, very good, but she almost blew it before she learned that simple truth. The boys are here, too. One so sure that love was enough. It isn't. You gotta fight for it, or it'll just get up and walk on. Another cat's hungry. Bread and chicks. Make them pay. Love is free, but sex isn't. Don't look back. You won't like the view. And what about you, man? What's your thing? You talk weird. What do all those words mean? Who are you? Don't look at me, man. You're not real. It's all here. Love, rape, murder, dope, grass, abortion, suicide. Something for everybody. Now hold it, man. Don't close your mind. This is what living is all about. Now and then, that's the people who make Beyond the Belly of the Dolls come alive are the largest introduction of fresh young talent ever presented in a major motion picture. Beyond the Valley of the Dolls is not a sequel. There's never been anything like it before. If you've been waiting for something new, waiting for a film to shake you into the freaked-out, mind-blowing scene of right now, then come and see it, man, and find out why it's called Beyond the Valley of the Dolls from 20th Century Fox.
So the question is, do you want to see Beyond the Valley of the Dolls or Snakes on a Plane?
I think I'll still have to stick with Beyond the Valley of the Dolls.
Well, after you've heard the trailer from Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, here's some audio from a special talking about talking with some of the cast members, as well as Roger Ebert, who wrote it and was, you know, teamed up with Russ Meyer. And I think they sort of hit the nail on the head on what the film is. Here are reactions from the cast members and Roger Ebert talking about Beyond the Valley of the Dolls.
I went to see Beyond the Valley of Dolls, and boom, it restored my faith in movies. It completely scrambled my notions of what's a good movie and what's a bad movie, because it rides that thin line between being absolutely awful and absolutely wonderful.
I'd like to strap you on sometime.
I felt that Russ Meyer was bordering between being a genius and a little crazy.
He was very upfront about what he thought the American mindset was, that basically America is very puritanical, but underneath it are all these little nasty thoughts. And he really wanted to play on that.
Russ once called himself the Grandma Moses of independent filmmakers, and that is a good description, because he stands outside all genres, all existing styles.
Beyond the Valley of the Dolls is a monster, huge cult film.
It stands apart from film history. This is one very unique viewpoint being put on film, and you don't see that very often.
It's the first rock horror exploitation musical.
Genius.
That was Roger Ebert commenting on it. Of course, he has a little stake in it because he wrote the screenplay. But here again, I love the reaction and the fact that this film straddles that line of being one of the worst movies and one of the best movies, because maybe because they're interchangeable. It's so good, it's bad. It's so bad, it's good, and so on. So, but, you know, to pull off a film like that with the chutzpah that Russ Meyer put into it, you know, just the calculation of Russ Meyer, I don't think there's a whole lot of calculation. I just think he moves forward, he knows what he wants, he gets it, and if only you could see some of the images that are playing as we play this trailer from some of his films.
Wow. Yeah. Just listening to that trailer blew my mind.
You know, our time is fleeting. When you talk about Russ Meyer, the time does go by. We do want to touch upon what I consider to be one of his greatest films. Let's call it, I would consider this the ultimate drive-in movie. Goes back to what, 1965? Russ Meyer's Faster Pussycat Kill Kill.
Three homicidal go-go dancers on a killing rampage in the desert. Tura Satana, Haji, and Lori Williams going nuts. How is that? Beautiful black and white cinematography, great dialogue, nutty music. This film has it all. I saw this at the Castro about 10 years ago on the big screen, and it left me absolutely speechless.
Here's a clip from Faster Pussycat Kill Kill. There's no explanation needed.
All right, here's how it works. Everybody's got to go. This way we're all safe, and we can all go back to our gigs. This will be just another deserted ranch house.
Deserted? With all these stiffs laying around? You must be kidding. Kill four people for what?
To miss the big pill they give you in this state.
I'll take my chances with the gas. I ain't sleeping good as it is, and a girl's got to have that good 8 hours.
You'd rather have a permanent rest then?
Not really, but I'll take the gamble. Who knows, I might get a judge with a thing for blondes.
Get out then. Get your car and split.
Well, I hate to break up the act, girls, but I always did want to do a single. See you in church, huh?
Did you get the feel for the caliber of the women in Faster Pussycat Kill Kill? I love the way you just promoted it there, Bob. You need to voice the trailer if they re-release this.
Oh, absolutely. I'd be honored. These chicks are hot and homicidal.
Well, we do need to wrap up. Bob and I have had a lot of fun talking about William Castle and Russ
Unfortunately.
Meyer.
Unfortunately.
Masters of exploitation and sexploitation. But we want to put Russ Meyer into a little bit of a framework here. We do have some more commentary from the special edition of Beyond the Valley of the Dolls. Here are more critics, including Michael Musto as well as Roger Ebert, kind of talking about Russ Meyer's place in film history.
The same reaction from people who email me and say, my God, I saw that movie. I had to watch it 3 or 4 times. I kept saying, what in the hell is this? Russ was very clever. He made a movie that everybody's got to see 3 or 4 times.
It's the favorite film of a lot of people because they felt as if we were getting away with something.
I can't believe it didn't become Rocky Horror before Rocky Horror. Maybe it was just ahead of its time. But it should have become the kind of thing where people dress like Z-Man and throw things at the screen and scream, drink the black sperm of my vengeance.
I feel vindicated today. I know that today that movie can play at the New Art Theater in L.A. and fill the house. There's been a tribute to Russ at the BFI in London, at the Cinémathèque Française in Paris.
It was honored at Yale, at Museum of Modern Art. These institutions have to be commended for saying, this is good. It's not all about, you know, Battleship Potemkin and Citizen Kane. Yeah, those are okay, but this is a lot more fun.
People have often said to me, I've never seen another movie like that, and it's probably true. Russ said it was the one time the inmates took over the asylum. Two complete outsiders went onto the lot of a major studio and made a movie by themselves without any studio interference. He created a genre and he dominated the genre. And he had a lot of fun doing it.
Well, there you have it. Russ Meyer, William Castle, guys who made films they loved on a shoestring budget in some cases, sold them very creatively, and they hold up today as far as being fun. I think that element of fun is in the most shocking of all these films even. There was a fun thing going on, and I revere these guys. I'm glad
they... As do I, Jimmy. I mean, just the idea, this is part of the reason why I love movies, and these two guys really, really do it for me. And I would recommend to folks out there, if you haven't seen any of William Castle or Russ Meyer's films, especially Russ Meyer's films, folks, don't be frightened by the sexual innuendos involved. They're not pornography. They come close in parts, but they're not. They're really very funny, tongue-in-cheek films, and I couldn't recommend films like Beyond the Valley of the Dolls, Faster Pussycat, Kill Kill, Vixen, Super Vixen, Beneath the Valley of the Ultra Vixens, Black Snake, Lorna. I couldn't recommend them any more. Or one of my other favorites, Motor Psycho. I couldn't recommend them highly enough.
Want to thank Hank for being projectionist tonight. Want to thank our listeners. And you can write to us at movies@kcbx.org. This is Jim Dee checking out. See you next time on Take Two.
And I'm Bob Whiteford. I won't be here next week because I'll be strapping it on. But we'll be back. But somebody will be back next week for another edition of Take Two. Take care, everybody.